happy Memorial Day to you all. Please take some time during the weekend to remember the fallen, those that have paid the greatest sacrifice that you could pay for our country. It's a solemn time to remember those that have died in the service of our country. As things continue to change regarding COVID, the session is continually monitoring the situation and making the appropriate changes to return to some sense of normalcy. That sounds like a rock band, some sense of normalcy. I'm going to use it. At its meeting on May 20th, 2021, the session has made the following adjustments to our COVID policy. Now, I think we're going to only do this Sunday, so we don't have to read this every single Sunday like we've been doing. Beginning May 30th, 2021, you will find that the hymnals, and that's today for all of you who are not sure, we will find the hymnals, pew Bibles, and pew cards have been returned to your pews. We triumphantly announce the Bibles are back and the hymnals are back. Beginning May 30th, 2021, which is also today, the deacons will be collecting the offering. However, the plates will not be passed down the pews. The deacons will walk in front of you with the plate, and you can drop your offering in it. Okay. The sign-in sheets will no longer be required to be filled out. Yes. However, pew pads will not be in the pews at this time. So we can't go too far with this. Right? We're partying here, but we can't get out of control. No. We will still be observing social distancing, and masks must be worn when moving about the building, but can be removed as you are sitting in your place. Amen. That was a mouthful. Yes, indeed. But we are taking baby steps. We love to say that in session. We're taking baby steps, and so you'll see more as time goes on, as we proceed, what is it? To return to some sense of normalcy. Today we welcome our brother Mark DeSantis to the pulpit. Amen. Looking forward to hearing what he has to share with us. Mark has a real deep desire to see discipleship in the church, and that's really a blessing. He also is a man of prayer. Mark loves to pray the using the office and the Psalms, and he's been doing that for years. And he is a good brother, and we're just very excited to hear what he's got to say. He's an elder in the church, and it's going to be good. Please join us next Sunday, June 6th, between services, for Lemonade on the Lawn. We are blessed to be returning to this time of fellowship. The office will be closed tomorrow, May 31st, in observance of Memorial Day. In addition, the Harbs Home Group will not be meeting in observance of Memorial Day. Hope Day will be held on June 5th, 2021 from 10 a.m. to 2:30 p.m. at True Light Church, 1850 Main Bayview Avenue in South Holden. That's normally held at the Polo Grounds in Greenport, but I guess they're doing it on the grounds of their church this time around. Volunteers are needed, and if you'd like to take part in that, you can. A training meeting will be held on June 1st at 7 p.m. at the True Light Church, so if you're interested in helping out with that, it is a blessing. Go ahead and do that. For more information, you can contact Tor Torkelson. And hopefully you got a pen ready, because his phone number is actually here. 516-807-2263. First communion for third and fourth graders will be held next Sunday, June 6, 2021, at the 9 a.m. service. There will be a short preparation class to be held today between services in the parlor. So I hope to be able to see anybody, the families of children with the children who are participating in our First Holy Communion service, and they're having their kids take First Holy Communion. I'm going to be talking about the meaning of the Lord's table and communion in the Presbyterian and Reformed tradition. The Cubies will be arriving on June 19th. Jeannie Berliner is heading the effort to stock their pantry, and I want to take a minute just to thank everybody that is involved in getting the manse ready. I don't know if you've driven past it. It looks really beautiful, and inside it really looks nice. Tom Woodle is painting it. And a lot of other folks are doing a lot of work. Rick and Joe have been doing work, and Rory has been doing work, and so many people are involved. Jeannie getting the food, and just other people too have been involved. Nancy, I think, was involved. And it's just been a blessing. I think they're really going to be blessed when they come here with the manse and what they find. And if you ever wondered if we are going back to a sense of normalcy, I have an announcement for you. The chicken barbecue is on! I knew that would get you. I knew it would get you. The date is July 10th. Contact you know who. It's the chicken himself. If you want to help. But we are so blessed that the chicken barbecue is on. Come on. Let's prepare our hearts to worship the Lord. Our call to worship this morning is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28, and it's a responsive call to worship. You'll find it in the bulletin. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me.
Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Also in unison, teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." Amen. What a blessing. That is a great commission. That is a wonderful way to start the service. If you are able, stand to your feet.
Thank you. The Lord is good.
All the time.
All the time. I had a wonderful opportunity to visit with our dear sister Joan Kiosky yesterday. My wife and I prayed with her, and I left her house so encouraged. God is so good. You know, if you ever want to see somebody who is just has the face of Christ, that the face of being filled with the Spirit is Joan Kiosky. In the midst of so much trouble and so much hardship and so much pain, she carries with her the mark of the Spirit, being filled with the Spirit. And just being around her is an encouragement. You know, when I look at how temporal this life is, how temporary it is, and I consider what it's going to be like to live in eternity, it takes me away. It kind of blows me away. You know, we go through a lot of things in this life, and some things are very difficult, and some things are hard, and some things change us. But we have to keep our eyes and our focus upon the Lord, like Joan does. We have to look to Jesus, knowing that ultimately He has the victory. And that one day we will all stand with our sister Joan and with so many saints before the very throne room of God, saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lamb. Hallelujah, holy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb." Lord Jesus, we dedicate this time to you. We lift you up and praise your holy name and give you glory.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
take a minute and just turn to somebody and let you say, and you know, we're not going to have to just wait too much longer.
I would like to call your attention to our prayer requests that are in your bulletin. In addition to that, I need to let you know that our brother Reg Minor was taken to ELIH last night and is going to be transferred to Stony Brook. I do not know any more details than that, other than to say that he is not doing well. Is that true, Robin? So we need to pray for Reg at this time and believe God for him, that God will raise him up and heal him. I would also ask you to take a look at the prayers in the insert. And we are believing God for all the folks on this prayer list. It is blue this week. Take a look at it for a minute. We are going before the very throne room of grace for help in time of need. That's what the scripture says. Our Lord Jesus is present here with us. Our Lord Jesus hears our prayers. Our Lord Jesus knows what we need before we even have to say it. Our Father in heaven cares for us. Our Father in heaven cares for every single individual on this list. And God is good. And God is a healer. And God is a redeemer. So let's join our hearts and our souls and our minds this morning together as we go before the very throne room of grace for help in time of need. Father, we thank you that you have called us to be your people. We thank you and praise you that you love us with a love that goes beyond our understanding. That you are our Father, and that you have said to each and every one of us who believe, you are mine, and I have called you, I have redeemed you, I hold you in the hollow of my hand. And Father, we know that you hold all of the individuals on our list in the hollow of your hand, that you are a healer, that you are a miracle-working God. And we ask for each and every individual here, Lord, that you would raise them up, that you would do a miracle in their life, that you would raise up broken bodies, people fighting diseases, that you would redeem those that were asking for their redemption, that you would heal people, Lord, in our community as well. We're thanking you for our community, and we pray, Lord, that because of COVID, that nobody would be given to any kind of depression or alcoholism or drug abuse, but we would be able to come out of this encouraged and strengthened. And that we would be able to come out of this terrible time knowing that you are God. And people would see that life is fragile and that they would come back to you. We're praying for a revival in our nation. We're praying, Lord, that you would be with our leaders. And Lord, I just want to offer up a special prayer for our brother Reg. We love him so much. We love this brother, and we put him in your hands, Lord. And we ask for your special care and protection over his life. We pray for grace for our sister Sheila. How they have encouraged so many. And we're asking, Lord, for your grace to encourage them this day and to heal our brother Reg and raise him up. Guide the doctors that are caring for him. Lord, we just take an opportunity now to bring up our own private prayer requests. Lord, I pray for all of our college-age kids, that the ones that are already in college that are coming home, that you would keep them safe as they travel, and that the time that they spend with their families would be a blessing. And for those that are getting ready to go to college for the first time, we pray a special encouragement of their heart, that you would be with them and bless them abundantly as they prepare to move on to this next important phase of their lives. We thank you and praise you for that, Lord. In Jesus' name. And Lord, we are so very thankful that that you taught us to pray. And we pray with the very words that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's continue to worship the Lord this morning.
Thank you.
Let's join our hearts and lift up our brother to you, to the Lord this morning. Father in heaven, we just lift up our brother Mark and we ask for a special blessing upon him as he comes to bring your word. We ask, Lord, that you would be with him in everything that he says and that he would be a conduit of your spirit this morning and that Jesus would be lifted up. And it's in that mighty name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pat. I think I got something in my eye, that last song, it's a little bit. Statistically speaking, most Christians will live their entire lives without leading a single person to Christ. That's an alarming statement, but stop and think for a moment. Who's the last person you can say you led to a saving faith in Christ Jesus? Now you're thinking there's probably, well, I talked to this person about it, I talked to that person about it. Next question, is that person ready to lead another person to Christ? Have you discipled that person to the point where he or she is ready to disciple another believer? Our work is completed when that believer can now lead another disciple to become a believer, and then disciple them to follow Jesus, and they in turn continue that cycle, so on and so forth, until the day that Jesus returns. This is the Great Commission. Remember the old shampoo commercial? If I tell two people, and then they tell two people, and then they tell two people, well, that's kind of like discipleship. It's how it works. And it's so much more important than shiny hair. I'm going to read from John chapter 17, which many of you are familiar with, the great priestly prayer. At the end of chapter 16, he was with his disciples, and he was telling them that he was going to leave and go someplace that they couldn't go. When he says, I have told you these things, this is the end of chapter 16, the last verse. I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, for I have overcome the world. After Jesus said this, he looked toward heaven and prayed, Father, the time has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son may glorify you. For you granted him authority over all people, that he may give eternal life to all those you have given him. Now this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I have brought you glory on earth by completing the work you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began. I have revealed you to those whom you gave me out of the world. They were yours, you gave them to me, and they have obeyed your word. Now they know that everything you have given me comes from you, for I gave them the words you gave me, and they accepted them. They knew with certainty that I came from you, and they believed that you sent me. I pray for them. I am not praying for the world, but for those you have given me, for they are yours. All I have is yours, and all you have is mine, and glory has come to me through them. I will remain in the world no longer, but they are still in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them by the power of your name, the name you gave me, so that they may be one as we are one. God's holy word. Amen. Did you notice what Jesus said in that prayer? The one verse that really jumped out. I have brought you glory on earth by completing the work you gave me to do. Completing the work you gave me to do. How could he say that when he had not yet died on the cross and risen from the dead? In his prayer, he said he completed the task of making disciples. His disciples were ready to go and make disciples themselves. All they needed was the Holy Spirit. If Jesus had died on the cross and not made disciples, none of us would have ever gotten to hear the good news. Jesus completed the message by dying for us and rising from the dead. And he created a way for people today to hear that message. by releasing his disciples to go and make disciples, who in turn were released to go and make disciples, and so on. Many of you have heard a saying, I don't know who actually said it, I think it's been attributed to St. Francis, it's share the gospel, use words only when necessary. And that's a great idea, and ultimately the message is that you need to live your faith and not just talk about it. And that's certainly a desirable quality in a Christian. But real discipleship requires words, a lot of them. Most of them are found right here. And the rest are spent usually discussing the word and how it applies to your life. It also requires an awareness of God's presence and an almost continual conversation and communication with him. Brother Lawrence insisted that to be constantly aware of God's presence, it is necessary to form the habit of continually talking with him throughout each day. To think that we must abandon conversation with him in order to deal with the word, with the world, is erroneous. He also said there is not in the world a kind of life more sweet and delightful than that of a continual conversation with God. They can only comprehend it who practice and experience it. Yet I do not advise you to do it from that motive. It is not pleasure which we ought to seek in this exercise, but let us do it from a principle of love and because God would have us. You do need to live the gospel, but disciple making is an intentional process. It can't be left to chance. You can't just assume that people are going to see what you're doing and desire Christ. Somebody's going to come and talk to you about it, and that's where you have to sit down and talk and just give him advice and guidance, him or her. In his book, The Unchurched Next Door, Tom Rainer cites a study that shows most unchurched people don't sense Christians attempting to share their faith, and that many wonder what makes Christians so hesitant. In other words, many unchurched people would be open to talking about Christ, but most Christians are reluctant to share their faith. In Romans 10, Paul writes, how then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? Who is that someone? If you want to follow Christ, it's you. You don't have to preach from the pulpit. The American College Dictionary defines preach, the number one definition, as to advocate religious or moral truth in speech or writing. And the number five says to give earnest advice as on religious subjects. Number six says to do so in an obtrusive or tedious way, as in stop your preaching. So we don't want that, the last one. We're not to be Pharisees. We're to preach using the fruit of the Spirit, using love, using joy, peace, patience, kindness, using goodness, faithfulness, using gentleness. This is a very important one. Not legalism. And finally, self-control. These are the fruits of the Spirit. The point is, many people are in dire need of advice and guidance in how to have a master-apprentice relationship with Jesus, the lover of your soul. He is the creator of the universe, and he wants to know you better. He wants you to know him better. He already knows you. This need exists inside the church as well as outside, and that's where you come in. The elephant in the room in today's church is Christianity without discipleship. It's a ludicrous concept. It would be like Phil Mickelson saying, I'm only going to show up on Sundays because that's where all the excitement happens. I don't need Monday through Saturday. That wouldn't really be a very good strategy. And it's not if you want to have a relationship with Christ either. It's got to be a daily thing, every day. According to our friend Soren Kierkegaard, it would be utterly impossible for the first Christians to recognize Christianity in its current distortion. He doesn't pull punches. Yes, they would hear Christianity preached and hear that what was said was true, but to their great horror, they would see that the actual conditions for being a Christian are exactly opposite of what they were in their day. To be a Christian now is no more like being a Christian in their day than walking on one's legs is like walking on one's head. Soren tells it like it is. Well, we're going to try to change that here at MPC. One of my duties on session is to lead adult ministries and adult education. And for the past year and a half, I haven't done anything because we can't meet. But we're going to try to change that and get the ball rolling. I had many meetings with Robert to plan discipleship training, but due to the pandemic, it never came to fruition before he left. We haven't been able to really meet in groups. And I've had conversations with James about this very thing, and he is totally on board. He wants to get discipleship rolling here too. He's recommended a book that he's used in the past, and I got a few copies for some people on the session. It's called Real Life Discipleship Training Manual, and it is a great resource. Lots of scripture, and you will be hearing more about this in the future. The plan is to have James work with the session to be sure that we are ready to be released on you. And then session members are going to lead groups interested in getting on board with becoming true disciples. It's a process, and it does, you know, the book is a 12-week program, but it takes a lot longer than that to make a disciple. They estimate it takes close to 5 years to really go from a spiritual infant to being a mature Christian. But this 12-week program is a nice start and get us started. It's only at the beginning stages, and I would say probably in the fall sometime we'll be bringing it to the congregation, September or October. But anybody who wants a head start can grab a copy of that book. You can talk to me if you're interested, and we will get you a book. Discipleship is not easy. It's very difficult because it requires an amazing amount of devotion to prayer, to scripture reading, to fellowship and discussing things with your brothers and sisters. G.K. Chesterton said, "The Christian ideal has not been tried and found wanting. Rather, it has been found difficult and left untried." And that's the bottom line. It's not easy. So I'm not going to sugarcoat it. It's going to take a lot of work if you truly want to be a disciple of God, but of Jesus Christ. But that's what it takes. Satan does not want disciples of Jesus. He'll do anything to stop that. Anything in his power. But remember, from the words of C.S. Lewis, he cannot ravish, he can only woo. So he can't force you to do anything, but he will tempt you. Jesus said, "If you don't hate your mother and father, you can't be my disciple." For all you kids out there or downstairs in Sunday school, don't take that literally. He just means that you must love him more than anything in the world, more than your parents, more than your spouse, and in my Ed Norton, dum-de-dum-dum, more than your perfect children. You have to love God more than your children, and that's tough. The command of Jesus is hard, unutterably hard, for those who try to resist it. But for those who willingly submit, the burden is light and the yoke is easy. Martin Luther gave my favorite description of discipleship, and I think I shared this once before, but you're going to have to listen to it again. Discipleship is not limited to what you can comprehend. It must transcend all comprehension. Plunge into the deep waters beyond your own comprehension, and I will help you to comprehend even as I do. This is God talking, by the way, not Martin Luther. Bewilderment is where the true comprehension is the true comprehension. Not to know where you are going is the true knowledge. My comprehension transcends yours. Thus Abraham went forth from his father, and not knowing whither he went, he trusted himself to my knowledge and cared not for his own, and thus he took the right road and came to his journey's end. Behold, that is the way of the cross. You cannot find it yourself, so you must let me lead you as though you were a blind man. Wherefore it is not you, no man, no living creature, but I myself who instruct you by my word and spirit in the way you should go. Not the work you choose, not the suffering you desire, not the road which is clean contrary to all that you choose or contrive or desire, That is the road you must take. To that I call you, and in that you must be my disciple. If you do that, there is the acceptable time, and there your master is come. If you want to plunge into the deep waters, I recommend reading the Bible, of course. But I would also advise you to check out some of the great Christian authors that are out there. They will help you understand Scripture. Put down the latest this week's James Patterson novel. Pick up Soren Kierkegaard, Dallas Willard, Dietrich Bonhoeffer, A.W. Tozier. There's so many more. And I'm going to close with a beautiful prayer from our friend A.W. Tozier. O God, I have tasted thy goodness, and it has both satisfied me and made me thirsty for more. I am painfully conscious of my need for further grace. I am ashamed of my lack of desire. O God, the triune God, I want to want thee. I long to be filled with longing. I thirst to be made more thirsty still. Show me thy glory, I pray thee, so that I may know thee indeed. Begin in mercy a new work of love within me. Say to my soul, rise up, my love, my fair one, and come away. Then give me grace to rise and follow thee up from this misty lowland where I have wandered so long. Amen. And now, can we sing hymn number 10, Majesty. Would you stand, please? Receive the benediction. No one knows who the Son is except the Father, and no one knows who the Father is except the Son and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Thank you, Jesus Christ. Thank you, our Lord and Savior, for revealing your Father to us. Whom shall you send? Here we are, Lord. Send us. In Jesus' name, amen.